Thank you everyone for coming. Thank you both of you for such very kind words. It is very much, I don't know if you know my backstory, but I think I need to sort of start there to explain the way I read, why I make works the way I do. So I used to be a professional ski and downhill ski racer and then a professional sprint cyclist, and missed out on a couple of Olympics and had to retire because I broke kidney bones and had all this experimental surgery and couldn't do any sport anymore. And I really miss that passion and that challenge of competing against nature and competing against myself. And so I didn't really know what else to do. And my mother and my grandmother both went to National Art School, and all my friends in my life said, "Go to art school." So I was like, "Yeah, I'm going to art school." I'll just do 6 months and I'll shut up. And I loved it, and I loved it. And I started out to, I suddenly realized that, you know, they talk about the catharsis of art, and it's actually true. I started out trying to do literal self-portraits of myself to try and deal with it, because I didn't know how to deal with the trauma of what I'd sort of been through. And I found that it wasn't really working, and then Bill Wright, who Tim just spoke about, came to my studio and he said, "Look, here's a huge roll of paper. Take it out to the bush and get inside the room. Stop painting yourself from the outside in and start painting yourself from the inside out." And that's what happened. So I started working from, so I literally stand inside the works and I go out to the bush and it's a response, my emotional response to what's going on with me, my past, my present, what's going on in the world, what's going on in the very unique landscape that I'm in. So every work I can tell you exactly what I've made. And I live out there at the works for weeks at a time. Sometimes I can leave from there. I've lost works all over the country. I don't know where they are. I've tried dams and God knows where off cliffs. And often I have to rescue them the next day and climb trees and they've been caught in avalanches and all sorts of things. So I'm treating myself. But so these ones, and what I do is I use the, so I got the excitement of the kind of like actions, I suppose, or not a dance, but it's like, it's my replacement of competing. So I get this huge adrenaline rush because I've got no control over what's going on. So I might be able to throw the paint in that direction, the big gust of wind, and we'll go over there. And then I've got this beautiful artwork, and then I go to bed, and then it rains through, and I'm like, oh. Wake up in the morning, it's all gone. But there's still a layer of history there that's really lovely. And I just work and work and work like that for a long time, and then the lands, the elements are as much an artist as I am, I guess, in a way. And I love that sort of trying to control the uncontrollable. And it's, for me, that's really exciting. I work, I use branches, I just use local materials. So all the colours that you see in these works is from where I'm at. So the pink ones are from Ross River up in the Alice Springs, the soil there is really pink. And the greys, the ash, which were out of the flies, the overflows, sort of up in the hills. And obviously, plant material or butterflies land in the work and get stuck there, then I can just pull down to stay there.
Find a new landscape and all that. You found yourself in Switzerland, you found yourself in So we had a charter, we were doing some charter.
I actually managed to break into the Shaolin temple. Not break in, but you were there training everyone for the Kung Fu monks. I got there in 3 days to find it, and I just knocked on the door and asked if I could train with them. So I spent 3 months training with, like, those 2,000 little boys. I was the only white person, the only foreigner, the only female that had ever been there. And it was the most amazing experience, but also half the training for me, because I say it was horrific. But I managed to meet this colony of calligraphic artists across the next mountain. And they taught me these beautiful, they gave me all these beautiful brushes and showed me how to mix Chinese, special Chinese inks in special ways. That's what all that mild thing is in that over there. They actually mix oil in with the Japanese ink and they use mud and they mix it all up themselves. So it's like pigment and blood and oil and turps and salts all sort of mixed together. And they gave me these huge brushes. But I use like mops. What's like I said, trees and things. Sorry.
What's the
My, I never use my own blood. I have a really great doctor that takes that for me. I have to explain that. Sorry. I broke 52 bones in my time as an athlete and had a couple of comas, had to learn to walk again twice, had a lot of experimental surgery done. I was always terrified of blood, but I had to learn to love it, and I suppose I kind of took that a little bit too far. But for me, because these works are such emotional sort of outpourings of myself, I guess, like I said, what's going on around, that it just felt natural to use my own blood. And it's actually a really beautiful material to use. And it's what ancient Japanese and Chinese ink used to be made of. So it's kind of fitting in a way, and I just sort of, I don't know, something that's a personal touch. No, and it depends on if you leave it in the sun, because it can change colour. If I seal it straight away, it'll stay bright red. If I leave it out in the sun, it will end up like a dark red. We never know what it does. But it's, I mean, apparently they used to paint old American shirts, you know how they're always red. They used to paint those with blood because it's such an amazing sealant. So that's why, now they use red paint, but that's where they
as a cast
I'm assuming not their own.
So, if I made a film on Sophie, the poor darling's living on the edge.
You wanted to talk about Austria? Mm.
Yeah.
No, it's probably
Austria. So you worked in quite a few different sort of landscapes.
Yes.
What is the one that's challenged you most in terms of that physicality?
I think my favourite has always been the Australian landscape. Yeah. There's only so much I can find in overseas, like the trees were all the same, or the, like when I was in Australia, it was exciting, and I got water avalanche, so it works, and I had to dig them out, and they ended up in the rubbish heap, and I had to find them again, and they were ones from the pole. They looked great in the end, but, you know, at that point, they were like twisted into wrappers. But I love that process that the works go through, like the history behind making them. For me, that's what's so exciting. For me, the process is far more important than what ends up on the wall. But what was your question?
Well, the next sort of challenge, I guess, the sort of
landscape
that you haven't sort of thrown
something into yet. Well, so I've done Paris, I've done Berlin, I've done Poland, I've done Hong Kong, I've done Austria. But like I said, like there was only so far I felt like to take it. Whereas in Australia bush, you can literally go 100 metres in that direction and there's a totally new inspiring work that I can see. So, and then there's such a vast array of different natural sort of features in Australia that it's endless. So I keep coming back here. I like going over there and having that experience because I love the culture and the history of all of those countries.
Yeah.
But I love, there's something grounding when I go out to the bush, it's like a deep resonating pulse that sort of puts everything into perspective and silences me. I've got no phone.
You should live with your work.
Yeah, it's just me and the work. No one can come and say and I love it.
Are there any artists in particular you refer to or that you would admire as being someone, as an artist who's perhaps helped you with some of your ideas?
Well, John Wolsey is a good example of someone who, when I was at art school, saw him dragging paper and stuff through, which I do often with canvases when I'm not sure what to do with it. Just turn it upside down and drag it to a level. And he does that a lot with paper and buries it, and it's absolutely stunning. Goya was always a favourite of mine at art school. I love the darkness in his work, obviously. And I love Cy Twombly, because of his writing and writing his text. Tapies, the texture that he gets into his work. Both Bertie Tapies, he's a Spanish painter, he's fabulous. Anson Kiefer. He also lives in the town for years in his life, and that's infested of spray. But I think what I'm trying to find is, because life is not all roses, we all know that. And it's, you know, you can't appreciate the good without having bad. It's, you know, the beauty and the horror. And in the art, so to speak, they talk about the sublime, which is the meeting of those two places. And that's what I'm always trying to find in my work. And so that frisson between the two. So they're not all pretty, and they're not too dark. It's, you know, it's the reality of life that you've got to deal with both.
So, I mean, I certainly get from your work that full spectrum, you know, so your words can take you to the abyss and then find you again.
Did someone record that?
They are inspirational.
Yeah.
Knowing that they come from a dark place and, you know, this physical, emotional response, yeah, they're very inspirational.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I guess what I love, I mean, I know the abstract landscapes, if you were just to give them a title, but for me, I love the fact that anybody, they're my story, but everybody can find a universality in them. Like, they can read their own thoughts and history and find something in each work that resonates with them.
I was just going to say something. Despite the seemingly haphazard way these works, as you describe them, seem to come together, there's a lot of time spent in the studio refining these elements and agreeing with them. What happens is there, but I think she spends an incredible amount of time just as opposed to coming together.
No, it's true. Once I bring drag back from the bush, once I think they're ready, I take them to the studio, I've got to figure out which way's up and resolve the composition, and that's very meditative and very, very slow, and that takes a long, long time just sitting and working through the works and just bringing them together, sort of reining in the chaos, I suppose, in a way.
Has anyone got any questions they'd like to ask Sophie? Yes, please.
Thank you, Sophie. They're beautiful. Would you consider yourself an extrovert or an introvert?
Oh, good question.
Really shy. What would you say?
I'm amazing.
Depends
on
how to
drink. If you were to say your art fitted in with a school of thought, or a school of art, past or present, which one would you align with?
I really don't know, because, I mean, you could say they're abstract expressionists, but they don't fit into that category. Either they can't make a dad's words. I don't know where they would go.
Yeah. No, that's why I asked
you. Do you do this because you have to, or because you want to?
Both. I would go crazy without doing it. When I'm not painting, I do go crazy. So it's kind of like my sanity, I suppose. And it's
a catharsis.
Yes. Yeah.
I read a wonderful quote of yours that it was art saved me.
Yes, it did. It really did. Didn't know where I was going after retiring from sport.
So if you just in terms of the scale and size of the paintings, is it unusual to have this many of this scale or?
Yes, it is. And they're normally that size, which is basically the biggest problem on the canvas I can get, I just cut it off at the edges. But then I know that most people can fit them through their doors, so I do try and make them like the size of the fit into a doorway. But then this year I crushed the nerves at the top of my neck and I couldn't sort of. So I had to downsize. So that's why I'm able to fit into the 50s.
So we're moved.
Margie, do you have a question?
Oh, yes. Tell me about a time that you really, really hated being in the city.
Most days?
To be able to want to be.
Well, I do live in the city, but I go bush or go overseas. Mostly go bush, you know, and make the work and then come bring it back to the studio, which is the city. So if I start going to do it crazy, I just leave.
Tell me one thing about the city that you don't like.
There's no horizon line, except in Sydney. I've been living in Melbourne. That really got me down. There was no, like out in the desert, it's like this much landscape and this much sky, whereas here it's all, what you know, it was all buildings and no sky.
Yeah. I mean, like,
it's just that being able to breathe.
Yeah. Living in cities like living in a fish eye lens.
Yeah.
But anyway, is there anyone else?
Yeah. What are you called at my time?
Because it's about the chaos and the grandeur of life and the landscape and everything that we all go through as a humanity sort of life's adventure. And it's kind of a crazy one. And it hurts sometimes, and sometimes it's brilliant. And I've always loved that word. And it actually comes from a poem by a short story by which is really beautiful. And it's always been a favourite for
everyone.
Sophie, when
you do training,
you
always
manage
to
come
in the
back of the hand.
Yes.
Do
you think about that before you start, or does that come out?
No. Sometimes. I never know what the word's going to be, ever. And I start, but sometimes I'm working through it. A name will spring to mind, or a poem that I've read.
It's kind of poetry.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I like the poetry of it because they're so sort of abstract. And a lot of the text is poetry that I'm inspired by all the words that spring to mind that are relevant at the time and something I express. And so, yeah, they're meant to be poetry. But they're generally named after the word is finished because I never know what the word is going to be when I start.